So hello all, in this video series of anatomy of abdomen, today's video will be talking about the different layers of anterior abdominal wall. Especially we'll be talking about the skin and superficial fascia. The muscles will be covered in the next video. So first, the layers present in the anterior abdominal are the skin, starting superficial fascia, external oblique muscle, internal oblique muscle, transverse abdominis muscle, followed by a fascia called as fascia transversalis, which lies deep to transverse abdominis muscle, and we also have extraperitoneal tissue, and finally parietal layer of peritoneum. So peritoneum has parietal layer and visceral layer. So visceral layer covers the abdominal viscera, and parietal layer is present in the anterior abdominal wall. So talking about the first part, which is the skin. The skin is actually thinner than the skin which is present in the posterior abdominal wall. The very important feature which is present here is the umbilicus. So umbilicus, it represents the site of attachment of umbilical cord in fetus, which you all know, which is a connection between the mother and the fetus, through which all the nutrients are exchanged and also the excreta of the baby is carried out. So it basically helps in maintaining the metabolism of the fetus. And talking about the position in adult, it is located between the L3 L4 vertebra, and newborn it is slightly lower because the abdominal muscles are not yet developed fully, and in old age people it is lower because of the diminished tone of abdominal muscles. So moving on, we'll be talking about the significance in anatomical and embryological aspect. So first one, anatomical aspect. So the venous and lymphatic drainage. Okay, so the umbilicus serves as the watershed line for venous and lymphatic drainage. What I mean by this phrase is that above the level of umbilicus, the venous blood and lymph flow upward, and below the level of umbilicus, the venous blood and lymph flow downward. Which you can see here. So above the umbilicus, the venous blood is carried upward to axillary vein, and below the umbilicus it is carried downward by superior epigastric vein to great saphenous vein. Similarly, lymph vessels, they carry lymph in the upward direction to axillary lymph nodes, and below the umbilicus it is carried down to the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. Okay, so it represents the teat and dermatome. So dermatome is the skin which is supplied by a particular nerve. So here it represents teat and dermatome, which is supplied by teat and nerve, and it is the site of portocaval anastomosis. So long story short, portocaval anastomosis is the anastomosis between the portal system and caval system. So what is caval system? Is caval system includes the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, which basically drains blood from the systemic circulation, which is the upper part of the body through superior vena cava and lower part of the body through inferior vena cava to the heart. Whereas portal system is actually different from the systemic circulation because it arises from the capillaries and ends in capillaries. This is a special connection between the liver and the abdominal organs. So there is anastomosis which is present between these two systems. So that is called as portocaval system, and in the umbilicus which you can see here, there is anastomosis between the superficial epigastric veins and the paraumbilical veins. So this anastomosis is clinically significant, which we'll be talking about at the end of the video. So talking about the embryological significance, firstly there is a physiological herniation of midgut loop in the fetal life. So to talk about that more, so in this picture you can see this is the midgut loop. The midgut loop herniates through the umbilical cord from the abdominal cavity. This happens during 5th to 10th week of intrauterine life, but this returns back to the abdominal cavity during the 10th to 12th week of intrauterine life. So this is one embryological significance. This happens because of the rapidly developing intestinal parts, but the surface area present or the volume present inside the fetal body is not sufficient. So there is this physiological herniation takes place, and after there is enough space, the midgut loop comes back into the abdominal cavity again. So the second one is the projection of allantois and vitellointestinal duct. Again, back to embryology, you can see allantois here and vitellointestinal duct here. The proximal part of allantois gives rise to urinary bladder, and the distal part give rise to urethrus. And the vitellointestinal duct, you can see here, this is actually a connection or a diverticulum of midgut, from the midgut here, and it extends from the distal part of ileum to the umbilicus. Distal part of ileum to the umbilicus. And thirdly, umbilical vessels. We all know through this umbilical cord, two umbilical arteries and one umbilical vein, they pass to and fro between the umbilical cord and placenta. So finally, clinical correlation. So this clinical correlation is based on the embryological significance which we saw now. So fistula and exome follows. In this picture, what we see here is the fecal fistula. So in the before picture, we saw about vitellointestinal duct, which is a type. So when this vitellointestinal duct fails to obliterate, this results in fecal fistula at the umbilicus, through which the fecus comes out. And this is one thing. And we have exome follows. So this is the exome follows. This happens when there is failure of midgut loop to return into the abdominal cavity. And here the intestine protrudes through a defect in all three layers of abdominal wall, through the umbilical ring, and a thin transparent membrane, the amnion, covers it, which you can see here. And finally, we have congenital umbilical hernia. So in this condition, the intestine protrudes through the umbilicus due to the weakness of umbilical scar. And here it is covered by skin. So the umbilical hernia is covered by skin, whereas exome follows is covered by a thin transparent membrane, amnion. Secondly, superficial fascia. So superficial fascia majorly contains fat, and this is a very major site for fat accumulation, especially in females, which leads to obesity. And this superficial fascia exists in two layers below the line connecting the two anterior iliac spine. So you can see the two layers here. The first one is the superficial camphor fascia. This majorly contains fat, and the deep membranous layer, Scarpa's fascia, camphor's fascia and Scarpa's fascia. Camphor's fascia is superficial, which majorly contains fat, and this Scarpa's fascia is deep, and it is made up of elastic fibrous tissue. So here you can see skin, superficial fascia, the camphor's fascia majorly containing fat, and Scarpa's fascia which contains elastic tissue. So camphor's fascia, it continues with the superficial fascia of the other areas nearby, which is the pelvis and thorax. So there are two modifications of camphor's fascia. In the pelvis, over the penis, it is devoid of fat. It majorly contains fat, but over the penis, it is devoid of fat. And in the scrotum, it is replaced by an involuntary muscle called as Dartos muscle. That is about camphor's fascia. And Scarpa's fascia, which I already said, it is made up of elastic fibrous tissue. So it has certain features. So you can see here the line connecting the two tubercules, above which the superficial fascia lies as a single layer, below which there are two layers, the fatty layer and the membranous layer. So in the middle, it is attached to linea alba. Linea alba denotes the midline furrow between the two rectus muscles, and on each side it is separated from external oblique muscle by a loose areolar tissue. In central linea alba, on each side it is separated from external oblique by loose areolar tissue, and below it is attached to fascia lata of thigh. So fascia lata is the superficial deep fascia of the thigh. The abdomen, there is no deep fascia, whereas in thigh The deep fascia is called as fascia lata, and it is attached to it. And over the penis, it forms Buck's fascia, which is called as fascia of penis. Whereas the Campus fascia, it is devoid of fat. And both Scapa's fascia and Campus fascia together, over the scrotum, they are replaced by Dartos muscle. And the Scapa's fascia continues with the perineum here, with the superficial fascia of perineum, which is Colles fascia. You can see this is the fatty Campus fascia, and this is the membranous Scapa's fascia, extends over the penis, forming the Buck's fascia. And over the scrotum, it is replaced by Dartos muscle and continues with the perineum through the superficial fascia of perineum, which is Colles fascia. So finally, the nerves and vessels present on superficial fascia. First, talking about, so the skin of anterior-abdominal wall is supplied by lower 6 thoracic nerves through intercostal and subcostal nerve. T7, T8, T9, T10, T11 are intercostal nerve, and D12 is called a subcostal nerve. So the inferior most part is supplied by the lumbar L1 nerve, which through iliohypogastric nerve and ilioinguinal nerve. So we have two branches, which are anterior cutaneous branches and lateral cutaneous branches. So these are the anterior cutaneous branches. These are derived from the lower 5 intercostal and subcostal nerves, T7, T8, T9, T10, T11 and T12, and also from the subcostal and iliohypogastric nerves. So they pierce the anterior wall of rectus sheath, the rectus muscle. Correspondingly, rectus sheath, they pierce that, and they divide into medial and lateral branches to supply the skin here. So we also have lateral cutaneous branches. The lower two intercostal nerves, T10 and T11, lower two, T12 is subcostal, so lower two is T10 and T11. They emerge through the external intercostal muscle and divide into large anterior and small posterior branches and supply the skin present here. And also the lateral cutaneous branch of subcostal nerve and iliohypogastric nerve appear close to the iliac crest and supply the skin over the upper part of gluteal region, which is back, not seen here. So and then arteries. So cutaneous arteries, we have anterior cutaneous arteries, lateral cutaneous arteries and superficial inguinal arteries. So first, anterior cutaneous arteries, they accompany the anterior cutaneous nerves. So these arteries are the branches of superior and inferior epigastric artery. So superior epigastric artery is the terminal branch of internal thoracic artery. Internal thoracic artery arises from the subclavian artery. So the internal thoracic artery has two terminal branches, which are musculophrenic artery and superior epigastric artery. So this the anterior cutaneous artery are the branches of superior epigastric artery and inferior, and the lateral cutaneous arteries are the branch of posterior intercostal artery, which you can see here. So anterior cutaneous arteries are the branches of superior epigastric artery and inferior epigastric artery, and the inferior epigastric artery is the branch of external iliac artery, and the superior epigastric artery is a branch of internal iliac artery. Internal thoracic artery, sorry. And then we also have three superficial inguinal arteries, which arise from the femoral artery. So these are superficial circumflex iliac artery, superficial epigastric artery and superficial external pudendal artery. So these are the cutaneous, sorry, and we have cutaneous veins. These are lateral thoracic vein draining into axillary vein above the umbilicus upward direction, and superficial epigastric vein draining into great saphenous vein below the umbilicus in downward direction. And also lymphatic drainage. So above the umbilicus drain via superficial lymphatics into axillary lymph nodes, and below the umbilicus they drain into superficial inguinal lymph nodes through the superficial lymphatics again. So these are the structures which are present in the superficial fascia. And finally, there are two important clinical aspects. So this happens when there is portal vein obstruction. So we already saw that the umbilicus is a potential site of portocaval anastomosis, which is the anastomosis between portal system and caval system. Here there is anastomosis between paraumbilical veins and superficial epigastric artery. So when there is venous obstruction, what happens is blood through these veins are obstructed. There is backflow. So because of that, the veins around the umbilicus, which is paraumbilical veins and superficial veins, they become grossly distended, and they radiate out from the umbilicus like these spokes of a wheel, which produces a clinical sign which is called as caput medusae. So this resembles to the serpents on the head of Medusa, which is a mythical lady in Greek mythology. So this is one. And we also have the caval obstruction, in which there is obstruction either in superior vena cava or inferior vena cava. So when there is this obstruction, there is opening of an anastomotic channel, which is called as thoracoepigastric vein. Anastomosis between the lateral thoracic vein and superficial epigastric vein. So when there is superior vena cava obstruction, the blood from the upper body passes through the lateral thoracic vein, moves downward through thoracoepigastric vein, goes to superior epigastric vein, and through that inferior vena cava and reaches heart. So in SVC obstruction, blood in thoracoepigastric vein flows downward. So similarly, in inferior vena cava obstruction, blood from the lower part of the body passes through the superficial epigastric vein, through the thoracoepigastric vein, the anastomotic channel, and through that goes to lateral thoracic vein and finally reaches SVC and finally reaches heart. So this anastomotic channel plays a very important role in case of superior vena cava or inferior vena cava obstruction. So thank you. This is all about the superficial fascia and skin present in the anterior abdominal wall. I hope you liked it. Please tell me what you feel in the comment section. Don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel.